Well, it's one thing to give a talk after Michael Moore. It's quite another to give a talk after Michael Moore. I'll try to at least give you something a little bit different. Now, I came here with a talk all prepared, and after a couple of days, I decided to abandon that talk and write this one. And the reason is quite simple. I just had the sense, in the course of what I thought were really interesting presentations, that we weren't really talking about one topic that I thought we were talking about, which is the interface between philosophy and neuroscience. And that motivated me to put this talk together. Now, I'm going to try and say things that are not tendentious, but I will. And I'll try to signal when they're tendentious. And I'll try to signal the degree of tendentiousness, but I'll probably just leave that to you. The basic motivation here is to just crystallize three or four issues, to get it as tight as I can, and to say this is where the action is. Because I just don't think we really have a clear idea of what the relationship is between philosophy and neuroscience. Then I'll say something about the law, but my buddies will take care of that. Okay, a little bit of self-promotion. So I published this book a few years ago with a good friend and colleague, Michael Carter. In this book, Minds, Brains, and Law, we talked about the interface between law, philosophy, and neuroscience, and our argument is that there are basically four kinds of issues: conceptual, empirical, practical, and ethical. We go through them. We talk a lot about the law, we talk a lot about philosophy, physicalism, all of the issues are discussed in this book. Now, I chose this cover, which, as you know, is Hieronymus Bosch. And the cover is a metaphor for the book. And just as it was insane, as the medievalists did, to look for insanity as a stone in the brain, this was the theory, just as that was insane, we argued, it was just as insane to look for the mind in the brain. So, that's my first tendentious. It's a kind of a revelation of my predilections. Now, this distinction, in my opinion, is fundamental. I invite you to contest it, and some of you probably will. There is an absolute distinction between empirical matters and conceptual matters. Empirical matters are matters of fact. And conceptual matters are matters of meaning and the logical relations between concepts. This lines up with neuroscience versus philosophy. Here's a statement of what I think neuroscience does. Neuroscience is all about establishing empirical facts about the nervous system, and cognitive neuroscience explains the neural conditions that make perception, cognition, affective and volitional functions possible. And most importantly, unlike philosophy, these explanatory theories are confirmed or inferred by experiment. So this is what neuroscience is about. This is what philosophy is about. Philosophy is a completely different enterprise. Philosophy deals with conceptual questions, and there are two primary questions that come up in our discussion. One are questions of meaning. How do we understand the concepts that we use, the concepts that we operationalize and put into experiments? How are those meanings established? And second, what are the logical relations between concepts? What is it to think? And what is it to think and reflect upon memory and the like? And how do these concepts relate to each other? Does it make sense to say that the brain thinks or follows rules, for example? Right? And some people contest it, for example, the very logical fallacy. But that's the job of philosophy. Now, I'm trying not to take a position on this just yet. My position, the only claim I'm making, is that these are distinct enterprises. Of course they are related, and the question is how they are related. But here's a tendentious claim from a recent neuroscience article, a great article, an explanation in neuroscience. There's no escape from philosophy. Now that doesn't mean, although it's true, that philosophy is the dominant enterprise. It just means that if you want to do neuroscience, you cannot escape philosophical questions. You cannot escape the problem of how do I figure out what this term means? What are the criteria for this? And how do I explain behavior? Now, a simple example, lying. Right? It hasn't come up much in the last couple of days. But lying, there are lots of fMRI experiments online. I find them astonishing. You bring in a bunch of undergraduates, you tell them to lie, they lie, you record it with an fMRI, and you say, see, now we have a neural marker for lying. First question, is there a distinction between lying and attempts to deceive? The answer is yes. Does the experiment make that distinction? Second, when someone utters a sentence that everyone knows is false, including the person uttering it and the person hearing it, is that a lie? That, I submit to you, is a conceptual question. Simple question, but conceptual nonetheless. And it demonstrates, I hope, in a very simple, straightforward way, how the conceptual and the empirical relate in a way that is, let's say, fundamental. Now, neural correlates and criteria. This is controversial. I am of the view that the reason a concept cannot be identical with a neural event is that the criteria for concepts are behavioral. You do not derive them from brain states. This article, which is absolutely fantastic, by David Arnold, about neural correlates, he does a very good job of explaining and going through the difficulties, the conceptual difficulties, of doing the kind of analysis that a lot of neuroscientists do, correlates for concepts. Okay? And so I recommend it to you. Yeah. Neuroscience and behavior. It's a different topic, right? But the question that we ask in this context is, what is a neuroscientific explanation of a phenomenon like thinking? And here, I draw the distinction I raised in a question, which is the distinction between metaphysics and models. Now, the metaphysics that most of, or all of you, adhere to is materialism. The idea that nothing exists unless it has a material form. This is a version of the dominant paradigm in analytic philosophy today, philosophical naturalism, right? Championed by Willard Quine. The fundamental idea there is that science contains everything we need to do philosophy. In other words, philosophy loses its status as the queen of the sciences and is coextensive with scientific discourse. A model for thinking that several people have alluded to is Fodor's computational model for what constitutes thinking. Now, Fodor, of course, has a metaphysical position, and a certain metaphysics can dictate a model, but these are two different things. You can be a committed materialist and have a variety of different models for explaining what constitutes thinking. Okay, now, Mark. This is a common mistake made by neuroscientists. Somebody had a talk yesterday mentioning Jean-Pierre Changeux. Now, Changeux wrote a book arguing that the aesthetic experience was what goes on in the brain. Now, what's interesting is that Changeux thought he was making an empirical claim about the nature of the brain, when in fact, what he's doing is making a metaphysical claim. And the claim is that aesthetic experience reduces to what goes on in the brain. And this materialist claim, you have to have an argument for this. And in this article, this is a review by Colin McGinn, and there's a subsequent exchange between the two of them. Great stuff, because McGinn is completely irreverent. Absolutely nails this guy for the proposition that, look, science is one thing and metaphysics is another. Stick to the science because you're not doing metaphysics. world, because you don't even realize you're making a claim that is metaphysical and philosophical, not scientific. Right? So they're two different things. Now, free will. A lot has been said about free will, and my two colleagues have done an excellent job. So all I'll say about free will is, well, if why does free will matter? It has to matter, because if there's no free will, then there's no responsibility. And for lawyers, we have two possibilities when it comes to free will. One is we can just bracket the debate and say, well, free will is not a prerequisite for doing the law doesn't require it, so we can just put it to the side. Right? Or you can just take one version of the compatibilism that Michael so clearly articulated, that's my preferred solution, and just move ahead. All right. Neuroscience and law. Here, Worse and I are like brothers. Right? Neuroscience hasn't done anything yet for the law. It's just a gigantic promissory note. What the fMRI does is it tells us things, it enhances, it provides rhetorical flourish for what the folk psychological concepts of the law already tell us. But the law ultimately looks at behavior. And behavior is the touchstone for deciding intentionality. And neuroscience hasn't yet been able to add anything to that. And until it does, it's really just, shall we say, something ahead. So I'll leave it there, and my great thanks you for a wonderful conversation.